So in the last lecture, we discussed this kind of wave function, which is a double layer states, but we symmetrize it to make it a single layer states. And we say that this wave function can be constructed using a particular parton. That we have a four parton, but this four parton glue into electron in this very particular way. Psi 1 times psi 2 plus psi 3 times psi 4. And then we emphasize that this particular combination is SO5 singlet as a subgroup of SO8, where we rotate these 8 real fermions. You know, 4 complex fermions, so it can be viewed as 8 real fermions, then rotate between them. And then as a consequence is that the edge state before projection should have a 4 complex fermions, so 4 chiral fermions, which can be viewed as 8 Majorana fermions. But because we do this SO5 projection, which act on 5 of them, so if you drop this SO5 invariant part, so the 3 of them survive, which is SO5 singlet. So that's why how we argue that these particular states, the bound edge states, have 3 Majorana fermions. So 3 Majorana fermions have central charge 1, 3 halves. So it's kind of non-abelian, it's not integer edge states. So that's how we argue this wave function is a non-abelian. Okay. So today I'm going to discuss how to realize that wave function in some double layer system. Yes? Hmm? You mean this? Yeah. Sometimes when you symmetrize, whole thing just become zero. Yeah, it can happen. For this, it doesn't happen. I don't know how to prove it. Just put this in the mathematic and symmetrize it. There's no plasma method. Yeah, this is a very, very good question. We don't know. And so even for this state, we don't know. And especially if you look at this pairing, this supposed to be p-way pairing multiplied by a Laughlin factor. But pairing wave function is algebraic. Not like a Cooper pair with finite size. The wave function is 1 over r. So one may wonder, is this a correspond to pairing with a very large Cooper pair, so maybe gapless? So that's my first reaction when I saw this wave function. So I really truly concerned this wave function may be gapless. So but I don't know how to prove it actually. And so one way to do this is this particular wave function is the exact ground state of a three-body interaction. So we put this three-body interaction in the computer and really do it. And for 15 electron, and you can extrapolate, you know, you do the 5 electron, you know, 10 electron, 15 electron, extrapolate to infinity electron, looks like a gap is finite. So that's all I can say. And so basically, this is a very, very good point, that when you have a commuting projector realization of this wave function, then you know it's a gap. The ground state have a short-range correlation. But however, these kind of quantum Hall states have chiral central charge at the edge. So there is no commuting projector realization for those wave function. And then in those cases, the best you can do is that you can show that those wave function are exact ground state of certain design Hamiltonian. But it's very hard to show there's a gap. So this is a bottleneck, actually. There's no very good proof of that. And I wish there's something more analytical we can do that. But we don't. Actually, there's a lot of story along this direction I probably won't discuss. But indeed, this is a very big issue. This is also very important because play this kind of game, you can get all kind of wave functions, and sometimes you may get a wave function which is has to be gapless. You know, there are certain cases the wave function has to be gapless. Yeah, but this case it seems okay. Yeah. Oh yeah, this yeah indeed. For this one, there's using this some kind of a column, some more sophisticated background the column gas. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So this one, I think there is a but I don't know how general it is. So this one, do you have other example one can do this? Oh, I see. But for the five-in case, whether does one can what one know there's a is in a screening phase. I see. Okay. Yeah.
And what is this a capital Z compared to the small Z?
Where's the capital Z?
You can find psi one, psi two, plus psi three, capital Z.
This
above.
Eight?
No, above it. That's the particle.
Oh, this is Z is because I have a W and a Z, and this capital Z is some kind of combination of Z and W.
Yeah.
Because we symmetrize, then when you symmetrize among Z and W, so these two become indistinguishable. So those kind of thing is called the capital Z. Yeah, that's so after symmetrize it, it's a combination of Z and W basically. So how to realize this particular non-abelian states? So again, this is some argument. So we start with a double layer system. In double layer system, there's this Harpins suggests this generalization of Laughlin state, which is called the NNM state, where N is the intra-layer exponent, and M is the inter-layer exponent, more or less just like a Laughlin state, but have different exponent. Okay. And then one thing we want to say that this NNM and N minus M zero are related because they are differ by this Laughlin state raised to M's power of the integer quantum powers raised to M power. And this more or less a similarity transformation. So these two states are very similar. You know, at least they're near non-abelian statistics are the same. Okay. So because this similarity, I will mainly consider this n minus m zero states. So either the 220 or 330 states. But the 220 and the 331 is similar. So although 331 is a more experimental relevant case, but here I just do 220 and 330. So okay, so what we want to do here? So here let's fix the intralayer repulsion to be some scale, like one. Okay. Then we just can change the interlayer repulsion. You know, if interlayer repulsion equal to zero, then just intralayer repulsion, then you know NN0 will be like a Laughlin state on each layer. It will be pretty reasonable states, you know. Okay, so that's very reasonable to think here NN0 is a ground state, just ordinary decoupled Laughlin states. Then we ask, as we increase interlayer repulsion, what's going to happen? The one thing is that when interlayer repulsion is very, very large, you should get so-called charge imbalanced states. Because to have an electron stay in two layers costs too much energy. They'd rather to stay in one layer, so only have an intralayer repulsion, no interlayer repulsion. Here, we assume interlayer repulsion go to infinity. So here is the charge imbalanced. Okay. So therefore, the picture is Z2 symmetry breaking. At the beginning, we have a layer exchange symmetry. As we increase interlayer repulsion, this is Z2 layer exchange symmetry is broken, and the charge want to stay in one layer, not the other layer. Okay. Yes?
I understand when M is 0, you have no correlation.
Yeah. That's right. So at NN0 state, no correlation. But here, if I have very strong interlayer repulsion, we just look at the system. We don't know what is the ground state. If interlayer repulsion is very, very large, all the electrons rather to stay in one layer, not spread between two layers.
But then I don't understand how that's consistent. If N and M is similar to N minus M, how can you say N and
Okay.
Has those correlations. And so you can accommodate the right hand side of your baseline, but the first state cannot, the state with a zero is the
answer. No, this is a different comment. This comment is 220 and 301 is similar. So here I talk about the 220, but you should think I'm talking about 331 to connect to experiments.
Okay, but I would think 331 knows about entropy.
Yeah, but even 331, no, yeah, that's right. But even for 331, when the interlayer repulsion gets too strong, 331 is unstable. They rather to go to one layer, just, you know, yeah. Even that is unstable. Yes? Okay, in the following sense, if you're changing, suppose here is a, you know, 220 is a bosonic state, 331 is fermionic state. You can imagine you continuously tune the electron statistics, go to anion, then to boson smoothly. Suppose you do this adiabatic tuning of statistics, then actually these two wave functions will be adiabatic connected via this adiabatic change of electron statistics. And so there are certain abelian things are changed, but a lot of things are very similar. Yeah. So certainly you can do 331, you know, with no difficulty. I just don't want to discuss too many different situations. Yeah. So that's a actually this is the way to if you do the same thing, you will connect Laughlin state to boson superfluid. You just tune the statistics, even integer quantum Hall states. If you tune statistics from fermion to boson, the filling fraction integer quantum Hall state would become a boson superfluid. So that's a way to say, yeah, boson superfluid and integer quantum Hall state are really similar. Then if you tune further, the filling fraction one would connect to the Laughlin 1/3 states. And actually, the filling fraction 2/5 state would connect to filling fraction 2 state if you do this adiabatic electron statistics tuning. And so that's kind of similarity I'm talking about. Yeah.
I guess you also need to support m is less than
n. Yeah, if m is bigger than n, things become tricky because of the, yeah.
You could say they're similar in the sense of,
yeah,
220 and 231, they both pay more attention to intralayer.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. From energy point of view, but from statistical point of view, they are also similar. They only differ by abelian statistics. Other structures very similar. So the main thing is that what happened in the middle? We know here is a charge balanced, here is a charge imbalanced. So in the middle, there may be something interesting to happen. Then here we want to say that to understand what happened in the middle, we should think about the exciton. In the exciton here, it means a particle hole in two layer. Particle in one layer, hole in another layer. That's the usual definition of exciton. But here, exciton can be fractionalized because we could have a charge 1 over n quasi-particle in one layer, charge minus 1 over n in another layer. So because each layer is a 1 over n Laughlin states, you know, and we have this sort of kind of fractionalized exciton. But then you can see that if you have a lot of this exciton with the same polarization, kind of condensing or accumulating, you get a charge imbalance. So this is the argument is that as you increase the interlayer repulsion, this kind of charge, this kind of exciton energy will be getting lower and lower, eventually become negative, and that's causing the charge imbalance transition. That's kind of a picture. Okay, so therefore, at a weak interlayer interaction, this kind of exciton may have this kind of dispersion relation. May have Roatan dip, you know. And then as you increase interlayer interaction repulsion, this energy gap getting lower and lower, eventually this dip became a negative energy. You have a condensation. But the condensation is interesting because the exciton here is not a boson, it's a anion. But here also have non-zero crystal momentum. Here one kind of not speculating. Maybe when that happens, you get a Wigner crystal. So this is you may get a Wigner crystal first. Then eventually Wigner crystal became charge imbalanced. So maybe there's intermediate state of a Wigner crystal. But however, in some other case, suppose you fine-tune your interaction of a quantum Hall state such that exciton don't have roton tip, the minimal energy of exciton have a zero k. Then when this kind of exciton condensed, it's really just ordinary k to zero condensation. If exciton is a boson, then you just get a boson condensation, you know. And however, if exciton is an anion, you get an interesting like anion condensation. But we know that anion condensation gave you Laughlin state, because we say, you know, Laughlin state like a fermion condensation, you know, 1 over m, filling fraction 1 over m, Laughlin state is like a fermion condensation. And it's similar to boson condensation. But if you have anion, anion can condense into some kind of Laughlin state with some power made up integer. So there's so it's still Zi minus Zj, some fractional power may describe this kind of exciton condensation. Okay, so therefore this is a so then we ask, after anion condensation, what do we get? So what is the state after anion condensation? Yeah. In a following sense, okay, so there's a lot of history here. We can view the fermion as a boson bound with a flux. Okay. And then we do this following thing. We make flux fatter and fatter. Okay. So if a flux is a very small, flux tube is very small, then it's still like a point fermion. But then if you make a flux tube fatter and fatter so that flux size is bigger than interparticle separation, then it's almost like a boson moving in the magnetic field. But this magnetic field is a combination of a background magnetic field and this fictitious flux magnetic field. And the Laughlin state have a design such that these two magnets have to cancel. So at that case, the Laughlin state can be really viewed as a boson condensation. And in this fat flux limit. Actually, we are going to use the same picture here. So how to understand this anion condensation? We know this anion can be viewed as some kind of a boson coupled to this background transaminal gauge field. So this transaminal gauge field gives you some flux. And for the thin flux limit, you get anion condensation. But when you make flux fat, it became boson condensation in some modified background magnetic field. So that is a picture. And using that picture, actually, you find after this exciton condensation, you get a charge 2e Laughlin states. So this is a Laughlin state, but for charge 2e. Somehow electron paired into a charge 2e object. This charge 2e object form a Laughlin state. And this is the state after this exciton condensation. So how do I see that? Well, it's again using this this tool. That's this you can see that NN zero can be described by a transaminal theory with a K matrix NN zero. You know, that's a just double layer theory. Okay. And then this, what is exciton? The exciton is a particle in one layer, hole in another layer. So therefore, the exciton corresponds to the charge of these two gauge field. You know, one gauge field is for the first layer, correspond to density of electron in the first layer. A second gauge field describes the density of electron in the second layer. So the charge of the first gauge field make a hole in the first layer, and the charge in the second gauge for the second gauge field also make a hole. But if a charge is 1 minus 1, then in one layer you make a hole, in another layer you make a particle. So therefore, this particular charge for the two gauge field would correspond to exciton. So that is one thing. Okay. And so when you have a lot of exciton, so this little j is this exciton density and the currents, and they couple to this. This little a in this way. So this mi is the exciton the charge. This a fictitious gauge charge for the exciton.
The j is external
current. This little j is exciton. No, just exciton current density.
But so last time you defined m, that was inside j. now
yeah,
J had an M inside the definition.
J, no, no, this is a, this J is a X time number currents and a number density, this little J. But this, when you have X time, they couple to both A1, A2, you know, here we have two A, A1, A2. But A1 see this J as a positive charge, but A2 see this J as a negative charge, and this is the matter meaning of this coefficient. You know, this M have a minus one, so this contraction here. So if it's a, I is a one, so that's a one times A1. If I is two, it's a minus one times A2. So that's a, so A1, A2 coupled to the J with an opposite sign. So that's this exciton. Okay. So, So this is a field. Okay. So now you can see that so why exciton have a fractional statistics, because this kind of exciton density coupled to this gauge field. And so this exciton, when you solve the equation motion, this exciton is addressed by this gauge field. And because exciton is stressed by this gauge field, so when you braid to exciton, then this exciton actually have a knob of fractional statistics. But however, if you add a Maxwell term, which I didn't do this, if you add some Maxwell term, you can control the how fat is flux. You can make flux very fat, you know. So therefore the J itself is a boson. You know, this J itself is like a boson field. It's a boson field. It is through dressing with a gauge field to make it an anion. So that is the picture here. And then, but here, the next what we do is following. We freeze this little a. We say, we suppose little a do not respond. We just consider the dynamics of exciton. But here, before dressing with little a, this one actually is a boson. So at the low energy, the boson may condense from a superfluid. So here we are really thinking about if exciton condense, though this little j exciton would condense to the boson, superfluid. So we should have this little a coupled to the superfluid. That is the low energy effective theory. So this is kind of a line of thinking. Okay, but how to describe this superfluid of exciton? Well, one can do duality, the same thing. You can see the exciton density and the currents can be expressed using a new gauge field called A tilt. And using this kind of a combination to using the A tilt to describe exciton. So this A tilt is our exciton field, and it's related to the exciton current density in this particular way. So here I want to say that actually, that's how these two little a come from. These two little a is related to the electron density and the current in each layer via a similar relation. So this little a1 would give rise to electron density current in the first layer. The little a2 would give us electron density current in the second layer. So now I say that the a tilt gave us exciton density in the current in the same fashion. Okay? And so what is the Lagrangian for the exciton condensation? Actually, it's very simple. In one form, is that we have a term with like a density square. That's a compressibility, you know, density square. And we have a term like a current square. That's a kinetic energy. When exciton moves, it causes some energy. So the Lagrangian in the field theory just J0 squared minus J squared. Now you can just plug this into here. Then this term became a Maxwell term for this little a tilt. And then this little a tilt would couple to the little a. This term would become this some kind of Chern-Simon term with a kind of cross the Chern-Simon term. Okay, so this way what we get is that we got a three gauge field Chern-Simon term. So now we have three gauge field plus little a plus a tilt. And then this we got a 3x3 matrix. Yeah. So and that's it. That's kind of the magic. This is a like a hierarchy construction. What I'm describing is really hierarchy construction of quantum Hall states. You know, when the excitation above quantum Hall state condense, we get a new quantum Hall state. How to derive these new quantum Hall states? So that's how we do it. First, we identify what kind of particle condense. How this particle couple to the previously already condensed particle. That's this way. And then we do the dual transformation for the condensing particle to make a gauge field. So we have one more gauge field. Then we get the Chern-Simon theory with one more gauge field and with a modified K matrix in this way. And then that's it. Then you get a new K matrix for the new quantum Hall state. So they can immediately obtain, after condensing some quasi particle, what is the new quantum Hall state. And so this is basically a recipe to get that. And then you can do this similarity transformation using changing to the field redefinition. You know, Xie talked about this by using some recombination of gauge field to the new basis. Then you find that this one can be written as a block diagonal. There are two n here, and this part is interesting. It's either if n is even, this will be 0, 0, 1, 1. If n is odd, this will be like a 1, 0, 1, 1. You know, that's your two case. But in both cases, this block actually is trivial. They describe a trivial boson or trivial fermion. So this picture really is stacking. We have a three gauge field, like a three layer. So one layer is a charge 2e Laughlin states here. And another layer is another two layer combined to something trivial. Okay. So so this is so that's it. So we can drop this, then it becomes 1 by 1K matrix. And 1 by 1K matrix is a Laughlin states. So this is really how we derive this result, that this phase is a charge 2e Laughlin states. Okay. And is there any question here? Yeah. Okay. Usually, if axion do not condense, then this J, this current, will be something with energy gap. However, only when this only when axion condense becomes superfluid, then the superfluid Lagrangian have this form. So when I write this Lagrangian, I already this Lagrangian is an effective theory for superfluid. For non-superfluid, I don't have this. I cannot write in this way. Yeah. So and then. Then when you do the duality transformation, this kind of Lagrangian became a Maxwell term. So actually, that's basically the Maxwell theory is a dual theory for superfluid effective theory. Dual effective theory for superfluid. Yeah. So this means superfluid. Yeah, for X time. Okay. And actually, this is a, so, okay. So now let's say how to describe a transition, you know, and So now you know that if I freeze this little a gauge field, only consider axion dynamics, it's like a boson condensation. If a boson condensation, the critical point are described by Ginsburg-Landau theory. So this phi is like axion field. You know, it has some five-fold theory, it's got the Euler theory for the axion condensation, for the boson condensation. Okay. And however, the new thing starts but now our axion do couple to the gauge field. So this is another way to write down. This is not dual version. So this is like a more ordinary field theory version. So this axion field couple to little a1, a2 via opposite charge. And then you have this little a have a Chern-Simon term. So this will be like a Ginsburg-Landau Chern-Simon theory. And when you fine-tune the alpha to causing the condensation of phi, that's what drives the transition. So that would be the critical theory. So therefore, if you want to study critical exponent, you should do this theory, the Ginsburg-Landau theory or five-fold theory dressed by the Chern-Simon term. It turns out that this dressing by Chern-Simon term is a marginal perturbation. It's a changing the critical point is still there, but the critical exponent is modified by this dressing. And so one still have a continuous phase transition. At least that's what people believe. Okay. Okay, and so this theory really describes NN0 to Charlie 2E Laughlin states. So this transition, it describes this kind of a field theory. But this is not what you want to do. Yes?
Well, so there's like an A1
minus A1 plus A2 combination correspond to the correspond to a different exciton, correspond to the both quasi-particle, both quasi-hole. Here we have quasi-particle one layer, quasi-hole another layer. So that's what determines this the A1, A2 coupling with this minor sign. Yeah. No, that one we assume have a big energy gap. They do not condense. That one is also there. You can have another field like a capital phi, which have an equal sign coupling. But there we assume this alpha is very big, have a bigger gap.
Well, when you talk about the matter field,
yes. Yes. No. So maybe that sum is what gave you the Laughlin states. You know, this sum gave you a Laughlin states. So that's another way using this Higgs picture to see why condensation gave you a Laughlin states. So basically, that's a very good point. You know, if phi condense, maybe you want to set A1 equal to A2. Then this term just became a single gauge field transaminant term, and that happened to be the effective theory for Laughlin states. So that's another way to derive charge 2E. Maybe I should do this way. this way is maybe more obvious. But here, my main point is here, when n equals 2, something, we get lucky. If n equals 2, it turns out that this exciton is a fermion. This n equals 2, this exciton actually is fermion. And this is a really complex fermion because this exciton and anti-exciton, the both are there. Without interlayer tunneling, even exciton number is conserved. So there's a interlayer, the number, electron number difference gave you another U1, and that's U1 is the exciton number, so that's conserved. So one can wave your hand to say, well, if they are fermion at the critical point, what it can be, well, it should be this derived fermion. So this is a one way to say, yeah, we should, maybe the critical theory is just a derived fermion with a very small mass. When mass equals to zero, that's a critical transition point. When mass changing sign from positive m to negative m, that's how we go from one phase to another phase. So this is a proposal. But then we check, it works. Actually, when mass changing sign, you know, this indeed this fermion just do the right thing. You just get a charge 2E Laughlin states. So I won't go into it. The reason I mentioned that because there's ambiguity. You know, how many derived fermion? Maybe you have two family derived fermion or three family, but actually one family happened to be right. You know, you have one family derived fermion, and then when mass changing sign, it causes a change of a transaminant term, just like when it's Poiseuille condensing. You know, there are some point detail here I kind of overlook, but the main point is that the critical theory of this very ugly, hard to deal with Ginsburg-Lander transaminant theory, when n equal to 2 get simplified, it became free fermion critical theory. Maybe plus some fermion interaction term is there, but however, for this massless derived fermion, the fermion-fermion interaction are irrelevant. So by ignoring fermion-fermion interaction, it's okay. So this is very important, is that when m equal to, for n equal to 2, we have simple story, that the critical theory is a complex fermion. Yeah. Yeah. So far, yes, but I will break that later. Yeah, you are magnetic field, yes. Yeah. Yes. Exactly. Yes. 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 Yeah, exactly. That's exactly how I relate to this picture. Because in this picture, when axon condense or not condensing, you can compute the change of Hall conductance in these two layers. And then when the mass changing sign is induced, the same Hall conductance change in the two physical layer. So that's how we determine, yeah, there's only one family derived family, not two family. If two family, it doesn't match. Yeah, and okay. So so this is really Michael's question. Is that, you know, here's a phase diagram. As a change in the interlayer tunneling, but we get a transition from 220 state to charge 2E Laughlin states. And this is a critical point which are described by massless Dirac fermion. Okay. But however, with interlayer tunneling, the things will be changed. Because interlayer tunneling here corresponds to creation of two excitons. Because for 220, the exciton is like is a half electron in two layer. When the two excitons combine, it really become an electron particle and electron hole in two layer. So therefore, interlayer tunneling create a pair of exciton. So therefore, the interlayer tunneling is like this, like creating a pair of exciton. You know, this precise exciton, you create a pair is like this off-diagonal term. So therefore, interlayer tunneling at the critical point behave like adding this off-diagonal term, which break the exciton number conservation. Yeah. And then once you have this, then it's a free fermion can do it. So it's the single Dirac point split into two Marana point. So therefore, the one transition became two transition. You know, as you're changing this coupling constant interaction, you first go into the massless point. It's a one Marana fermion became massless. Then another Marana fermion became massless. Because this complex fermion can be viewed as two Marana fermion. But these two Marana fermion became massless at different points. So you have a two transition. So this is already very interesting. So we have a 220, and through a phase transition of a massless Marana fermion go to another state. And here, again, we wave a hand. This state in the middle is a symmetrization of 220 states. Why? Because the tunneling really want to make the fermion two layer the same. You know, it's like you want to have some kind of symmetric superposition is a lower, unless symmetric superposition is higher. So in a symmetric superposition, you don't, you know, what to say in electron in the first layer, second layer doesn't make any sense. So again, this is I can wave hand to say tunneling have effect of a symmetrization. So this is a kind of conjecture here. And then we say that this symmetrization is a Pfaffian state. So this we say that 220 can go into the Pfaffian state where the critical theory is a massless Marana fermion. And the Pfaffian state can go to a charged 2E Laughlin state where the critical point is a Marana fermion. So that is the main point. Again, there's I don't have a derivation, but a lot of plausible argument. Then you can get this picture. And for the 330, you have a similar story. This symmetrization for 330, there's some debate what it is. And at the beginning, we thought this is some orbifold non-Abelian states. But there's other proposal, and maybe that's still open issue. And there is more complicated because there we really have anions. It's not a fermion, so we don't have a free fermion picture. You know, here we have free fermion, so we are pretty confident this kind of phase diagram. There you really have Gibbs-Landau chain summon theory. I don't know what is phase diagram. I guess arbitrarily drawing one. So that's one possibility. But the main thing is that it seems it's worthwhile to looking for a non-Abelian state in double layer system by tuning the interlayer coupling and tuning the interlayer repulsion. Explore the phase diagram, and you may see it. And last week you're probably here. That actually numerically one saw it. So this is really a double layer numerical calculation by Dan Sheng. And So he do a fermion, so that's always 3-3-1. And so by tuning, by increasing the interlayer tunneling, they go to the Pfaffian states. So I think this phase diagram is kind of like this phase diagram, maybe say here, you increase coupling, interlayer tunneling, you're from 2-0 to Pfaffian states. So that's basically this phase diagram. So so there's a so numerically that seems a case, but certainly with this you can do 3-0. What happens? You know, that's another story. So this is kind of a suggestion that you know, we're not just playing mathematical games. You know, those construction can lead to the mechanism, maybe some suggestion what kind of system can realize those states. Okay, so any question here? Yeah. Yeah, this is a pretty weak argument, but it's really the following. And when you have interlayer tunneling, the electron in two layer have this symmetric state, like C1 plus C2 is have a lower energy, C1 minus C2 have a higher energy. And if a C1 plus C2, if you look at C1 plus C2, it's almost like exchanging C1 C2 don't change anything. So therefore, this interlayer exchange, C1, C2 exchange, this Z2 symmetry is gauged, become redundancy. You can see in the usually exchanging C1, C2 is a symmetry. You know, the Hamiltonian don't change, but the state changes. But when you look at this symmetric combination electron, C1 plus C2, this combination, the C1 exchanging C1, C2 don't change the wave function at all. So this is a, theoretically, it's really that, you know, for the 2-2-0 states, we have an interlayer exchange Z2 symmetry. But however, this phase transition is like gauging the Z2 symmetry. So you want to gauge this interlayer exchange Z2 and to get there. That's how we think this is orbital states. From 3-3-0, when you're gauging the Z2 symmetry, you get orbital the theory. And here, for 2-2-0 Chen Samman theory, if you're gauging the Z2 symmetry, you do get the Pfaffian states. So this can also be interpreted as orbital states, orbifold states, which is happen to be Pfaffian states. This works here. And so this is really some kind of a physical realization of gauging. You know, by increasing interlayer coupling, you actually gauge the interlayer exchange symmetry. And after gauging, you may get a new kind of quantum Hall states by gauging the Z2 symmetry. Yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah.
Suppose I start from having Z1 state, which has the image description, and now that we think of the interlayer tunneling.
Yeah.
I think this is equivalent to adding many.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, there is a more difficult, and and you can see what I did here is that I tried to drive the system very close to the critical point, and then I use this the massless Dirac fermion as an effective theory near critical point, then do my argument. So the picture you describe is very far away from critical point. You do have exciton, you can really have very strong exciton condensation. But however, the low energy effect theory is not a fermion theory. So it's harder to understand what is the effect of exciton condensation. But however, when you drive by tuning the interlayer interaction, by driving the system near the critical point, I have argument is that at the near critical point, it's really this free complex fermion is a low energy effect theory near this critical point. So that's how I make an argument. You know, we don't need that, but to make argument possible, I need to do that. You know, near this critical point, all the interaction term became irrelevant. I would drop them. You know, in the situation you described, interaction term are equally important. It's very hard to say. But on the other hand, your point is very good. Actually, there may be a way to make an argument without go near the critical point. And so I don't know how, but I just want to say that here the X time is a fermion. And when you have interlayer tunneling, you induce a lot of fermion. But the fermion number is not conserved, only Z2 conserved. So basically you almost want to say when you have very strong interlayer tunneling with only Z2 conservation, you get some kind of a superconducting state. Or maybe it's a P wave. And then we have when axon form a P wave, well that looks like a far thing. I think that's maybe the picture. You know, without going near the critical point, this axon condensation just drive into P wave. So basically you say this fermionic axon condense into P wave states. Because we only have one species of fermion, we don't have a spin. So the simplest assumption is P wave. But then with this picture, one may ask, why not F wave? You know, if this axon condenses to F wave states, not be, yeah, you may have something. So yeah, this would be very interesting possibility. Yeah, one could condense to F wave states, and or maybe go to, there's another possibilities. You know, there's a lot of things one can be done here. Yeah. Also fermion, yes, it don't change. Yeah. Oh, this, I'm sorry, this M is a mass of X time. Oh, yeah, this, okay, this is something I want to hide. So you can see here we want to create X time. You know, this operator basically create an X time. Okay. But actually, we know that exciton carry gauge flux. You know, exciton is a boson plus a gauge flux. When you create n exciton, you not only create n boson, you also create n flux. And it's very hard to express that in field theory. An operator which creates n flux is a monopole operator in the pass integral. So actually, I don't know how to write them. You know, when I do pass integral, I know whenever I have exciton tunneling events, I should also put a monopole of a gauge field there. But there's no way to express this this picture using the Lagrangian formalism. So this M is just a reminder, you know, when you do pass integral, you should also insert a monopole there. Oh, this here the exciton with an n zero state, the single electron tunneling corresponds to n exciton. You know, each exciton is a charge 1 over n.
Oh,
so when you have a n exciton become charge 1 minus 1, so that corresponds to electron tunneling. Yeah. So therefore, for n zero state, a electron tunneling corresponds to create n exciton. When n equals 2, you create a 2 exciton, so now become quadratic. So again, everything works very well for n equals 2. It's become quadratic theory you can solve. That's right. But however, exciton is a fermion. So therefore, this is an effective theory for exciton only. So near critical point, exciton is the lower line, which is some kind of fermionic theory. And the point is that in this case, exciton is a fermion and the interaction is irrelevant, so it's pretty easy to study the critical behavior. So this is really a lucky. So this is really a lucky situation. Okay. Yeah. Okay, you really condense a phi bound with the flux. So this picture means. And this psi is really fine bound with the flux. Psi is already fermion. You know, this phi is a boson. That's a very good question. But when you do the condensation in this transparency, I kind of freeze little a. Only consider the core of exciton. You know, exciton is a core, which is a boson, binary is a flux. Here, I freeze the flux, only consider the core, which is a boson, then this is OK. So that is a duality. But however, if exciton binary is a very thin flux, they move together, behave like a fermion, then I should not do this. Yeah. But however, it's a more correct picture would be this picture. This fermion picture is close to that situation. So the fermion condensation is like changing sign of M. So it's very, very different from boson condensation. Yeah. I don't know you guys how to do that. Yeah. So what I want to say that I consider a particular way of condensation, assuming flux is large, do this boson condensation. So this is the particular condensation. And in this way I get a charge 2e, I get a complex fermion, I get a Marano fermion, I get all that. But this is approximation because the smearing flux may not be right thing to do, and if you do not smear flux, maybe there's other thing may happen. But if a flux does smeared, then this is what's most likely to happen. Yeah. Any question? Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. It's falling. This free fermion picture and the smear flux picture happen to be the same. Okay. Yeah, that statement. Suppose this smear flux doesn't work. It's some other kind of exciton condensed to some other state. You know, smearing flux is really assuming exciton condensed into particular Laughlin states. But when exciton energy became negative, the exciton gas may form a very weird states. It may not be the simplest Laughlin states. For that kind of condensation, this fermion theory probably is also a mess. You know, we don't know what it is. I just say when the exciton condenses to the most natural Laughlin states, then you can use a smearing picture or using the free fermion picture. These two pictures agree. Yeah, that's an argument. Yeah. Yes, I agree. I think the in that case, because exciton is here, the exciton is a fermion. So but indeed, you want this fermion to condense to p plus p states. I didn't study this, let me guess. Okay. Without interlayer tunneling, the exciton number is conserved. When exciton condenses, it naturally condenses to filling function and quantum Hall states. And when exciton condenses into filling function quantum Hall states, you get to here. So with interlayer tunneling, the exciton number is not conserved. So this phase transition of condensing to integer quantum Hall states split into two, with the intermediate states of p plus ip. And which is reasonable because so one condensation, you get p plus ip. Another condensation, you get another p plus ip, and two p plus ip is an integer quantum Hall states. So they all match. So I think that's another picture. And this work is done before this picture became popular. So I think nowadays using that picture maybe it's easier to understand. But however, I think the message here, I really want to make a message is that this increasing interlayer tunneling is like gauging the E2 symmetry. This is a pretty general statement. So maybe via some kind of double layer states, we increase interlayer tunneling, there's a possibility you get a state with a gauged interlayer exchange. And that's gave you some kind of orbifold states. And I don't know how general this picture is, but at least this kind of transition can also be viewed as orbifolding or gauging the Z2 symmetry. Yeah. Gauging really means that, you know, when you, in a strong interlayer tunneling case, the low energy electron really the C1 plus C2, this combination. In this combination, the interlayer exchange became a do-nothing operation, and it became redundancy. Again, this is nothing rigorous, but this is a line of thought to say, yeah, maybe gauging the Z2 symmetry is not unreasonable. And so that's a motivate us to try to understand this state using the 220 Chern Simons theory plus a gauged Z2. Then whether you can get a let me get another theory for these states. Yeah. So there's a lot of game I can play here. And okay. And so this is about the quantum Hall states. So next I kind of want to switch gear, so unless there's another question about this. Okay, so I will switch gear. And so far we mainly talk about this project construction on the in the continuum space. So now let's do the project construction on the lattice. Try to construct some spin liquid states. In particular, trying to construct Z2 spin liquid states. So here is we have a spin 1/2 system on lattice. Okay. We view spin down as an unoccupied state, and a spin up as a one boson. So we map a spin 1/2 into the hardcore boson, basically. Okay. So, and then we do this pattern construction, a projective construction. We split this boson field into two fermionic patterns, just like this. So we view this boson as a bound state of psi 1 and psi 2. Two pattern. Okay. And then we can play games. Then we say, okay, then we first assume these two patterns are independent. Okay. And then we just assume this independent pattern described by some kind of a lattice a hopping Hamiltonian. So this pattern hop in the lattice. But this hopping is a 2x2 matrix. You may rotate this 1 and 2. You know, this 1, 2 pattern form S2 doublet. So therefore, this hopping may have S2 rotation. So some generic hopping model, and you get this pattern. So and the ground state of this so-called mean field pattern Hamiltonian gave us this mean field pattern state. So that's something we can do. And then next is a projection. And projection is very simple, just tie two patterns together, just tie them together, just as we did before. And but however, the projection really means the following. Only two states are physical. Either downspin state corresponds to no pattern, the upper spin state corresponds to two pattern, double occupied states. These two states are legal. The illegal state is the state with one pattern per side. So you have two such states, which are illegal. This projection just want to project all these one pattern precise states. Keep the zero pattern or two pattern double occupied state. Okay. But this both state are S2 singlet. This is S2 singlet. This is also S2 singlet. So you can see that this projection basically is like a project into S2 singlet sector. But per site, S2 singlet per site is not a global S2 singlet. It's on every site S2 singlet. So that means gauge field. And so therefore, so this projection to S2 singlet give us a physical wave function, which is a spin wave function. Now there's this is a wave function for the spin, because you only have a 0 and 1, or up and down. So this is a wave function for spin. Then we ask similar question. What is the low energy effective theory of this projected wave function? Then we just from mean field theory, we just add S2 coupling. That's it. So effective theory is a lattice SU2 gauge theory. We start from mean field theory. We add SU2 coupling. So this is SU2 gauge field on the link. And this is SU2 gauge field A0. It's to make a projection. So the Gauss's law, this is really the gauge theory to say this A0 gauge field is really make the projection of a singlet per side. But anyway, so this became a standard SU2 lattice gauge theory coupled to fermion. And that's it. So this one page is a theory of HTC. So actually in the early days, HTC, people play this kind of game. You know, that's how you get a spin liquid at a half feet without doping. When you dope the spin liquid, you may get a theory of HTC. And but the idea to get a spin liquid basically is that's it. And then you can, there's a lot of choice of this mean field ansatz. UIJ is like a mean field ansatz, you know. And by picking different UIJ, you get a different wave function after projection. So therefore, this UIJ is like a variational parameter. And you want to choose a UIJ to minimize this trial wave function's energy, to minimize energy of the trial wave function. And then you can get all kind of spin liquid by choosing different UIJ. And so that's a game people play maybe 20 years ago. And that's really a theory. So usually this theory is to give you a spin liquid theory. So any question here? Yeah. So that's a very quick introduction of a spin liquid theory. So now it's an application. Suppose we have some Hamiltonian such that this kind of UIJ minimize energy. You know, I don't know which Hamiltonian, but suppose there is such Hamiltonian and this UIJ minimize energy. Okay, so it's kind of complicated. You can see for the nearest neighbor hopping, we only have sigma 3. But for diagonal hopping from I to I plus I plus Y, this diagonal hopping on square. So here I assume square lattice. I'm sorry. I assume square lattice. Then the diagonal hopping, you get this sigma 1, sigma 2, some kind of rotation. Then for the other diagonal, you get a sigma minus sigma 2. So there's all kind of, so therefore for sigma 2 is like a D wave, you know, for different diagonal, you're changing sign. Sigma 1 part is not D wave. Yes?
So you're not
sigma 3 diagonal. Oh, that's a hop from I to I plus X. X is a unit vector in X direction. Sigma 3 means this is 2x2 matrix. Sigma 3 is poly matrix. So UIJ are all 2x2 matrix. So that means the first parton and the second parton with opposite hopping amplitude. When you have a nearest neighbor hopping. Yeah. But however, when you have a diagonal hopping, it's even rotated in the XY plane or something like this. It's a more complicated hopping. Yeah. And this kind of, so next thing I didn't want to say that is after projection, this wave function actually have all the symmetry, including spin rotation and the time reversal. They are not obvious here, but they are. So this again, there's a whole new topic of a project symmetry group get involved here. So this is a state which do not break any symmetry. Okay, and also, when you plug this ansatz into this mean field pattern wave function, you can see that all the fermions are gapped. Sorry. Yes. So all the fermions are gapped. Okay. So therefore, but this you need to do some remarks. Okay. So there's no gapless excitation in the fermion part. But however, you also have SU2 gauge field. So the one concern that maybe SU2 gauge field is gapless. So maybe this theory is a gap theory. So here we'll try to say that what this answer describes a gapless theory or gaps theory. That's what we try to figure out. Fermion part is a gap. But what about the gauge part? But the gauge part is that this A0 and the flux is behaving like a Higgs field. So here I want to explain a little bit. For the A0, A0 is 2x2 matrix. So under SU transformation, it just transforms like this way. So therefore, it's a like a vector Higgs field. You know, A0 is like Higgs field. That's simple. But what is this flux? The flux is a this 2x2 matrix. Remember, this hopping is a 2x2 matrix from I to J, J to K, K to I. So we go along a triangle. So when you do one hopping, another hopping, you do three SU2 rotation. When you go on a loop, you actually describe the SU2 flux through this triangle. So therefore, this production of the three hopping matrix describe SU2 flux through the triangle. And this SU2 flux also transform like a vector, and the global SU2 transformation also transform like that. So therefore, this flux also like a Higgs field. And the design of this ansatz is such that these two Higgs field is non-zero in this ansatz, and point in different direction. So one Higgs field point in this direction, another Higgs point in another direction. So when you have two Higgs field point in two directions in the SU2 space, you break SU2 down to Z2. If you only have one Higgs field, then the rotation around this Higgs field always leave you one. So one Higgs field can only break SU2 down to U1. So now the design of the ansatz is that you have two Higgs field, which break SU2 down to Z2. So therefore, the low energy effect theory is like SU2 gate theory with two Higgs field and break down to Z2 gate theory. So therefore, the low energy effect theory is a Z2 gate theory. And that is the argument. So again, it's a little bit magical is that you choose a particular ansatz to get the mean field wave function, do the projection, then you say, yeah, this effect theory of this is a Z2 gauge theory. So that's how we argue this is a Z2 gauge theory. Okay. And for the Z2 gauge theory, now we heard a lot of Z2 gauge theory. So basically, the Z2 gauge theory have a excitation, which is a standard Z2 gauge theory have a Z2 charge, which is called the E, the Z2 vortex, which is M, both are boson. And you have E and M bound states, which is fermion, because E and M have a mutual pi statistics. So that we heard a lot about this. But how about the Z2 gauge theory of the model we just constructed? Okay, so here is that. The Z2 charge is our parton, which actually is a fermion. You know, because the parton really coupled to the Z2 gauge field directly. So that's so Z2 charge is a fermion. Okay. The Z2 vortex, what is Z2 vortex? Z2 vortex is a particular excitation that we change, you know, this Aij is a gauge field. So that's the Aij is a minus one on this red link. So sorry, e to the I Aij is 2x2 matrix, which is a minus one on the red link. So so this kind of configuration costs energy at the end, and because here you have actual pi flux in this plaquette. So this is like a vortex. So this it costs energy here, but here they don't cost any energy. So actually it's just like a ground state, and so there's a point-like excitation at the end of this this flux link is a flux, and this is a M particle, and we don't know what is the statistics. So let's assume maybe boson, maybe fermion. So we don't know what. So at the moment, for this theory, we don't know. And then if this M particle is a boson, their bound states will be fermion binding with boson should give us a fermion. But however, because E and M have a pi mutual statistic, which is remain to be the same, then the boson fermion with a mutual statistic give us a boson, not fermion. Yeah, so however, if a vortex is a fermion, we'll get the fermion. So now we have two choices. Either fermion, boson, boson, that's just like this. It's just the labeling are switched. Or we have a three fermion. So there's a two possibilities we couldn't really determine from this particular theory. Okay. And but however, I think, I don't know anyone talk about this. This three fermion theory have a time reversal anomaly. So that's what it really means, that this is three fermion theory have no time reversal invariant realization in two dimension. And but we already say that these ansatz do not break time reversal symmetry. So actually, this wave function after projection have time reversal symmetry. So so therefore, with this new piece of information from the SPT study, we can say that this is realized. So this is really just a Z2 gauge theory. Yeah. So that is a kind of argument. Then you may say, why you say three fermion must have a time reversal, anomaly? You know, how do you know that? I think maybe later I will talk about this. But here, I just want to say that, you know, we know that we have a three fermion, and also another particle have a trivial particle is boson. So trivial particle always boson. So we have a four particle, trivial plus three non-trivial, so one boson, three fermion. So we basically know the statistical content. And then there's a magical formula from the tensor category theory that if you know the statistical content of the of your particles, you can compute the chiral central charge of edge states up to 8, you know. And here, if you plug in these statistics into that formula, you find the chiral central charge for edge states should be 4 mod 8, either 4 or 12, you know, or 20 or something like that, but cannot be 0. If chiral central charge cannot be 0, you must break time reversal symmetry because the edge states have this preference. So this is that is a reason. Okay. So this is so that's how we get rid of this possibility. But however, for the two boson one fermion possibility, when you plug into that formula, you find the chiral central charge can be 0. So this is consistent with the time reversal symmetry. So it's pretty magical because from a statistical point of view, you know, both the boson statistics, the fermion statistics, we will do exchange either plus one, minus one. There's no I. So it looks like it's time reversal symmetric. It should be compatible with time reversal symmetry. But amazingly, this three fermion choice is incompatible with the time reversal symmetry due to some pretty subtle reason. Yeah. Okay, yes.
How did you argue that your A0 field breaks up?
No, it don't. So in this ansatz, in this particular ansatz, the A0 is non-zero, and the phi is non-zero. Both are non-zero. So that's behavior like we have a two field which transform non-trivially under SU2, and both are non-zero. So means we have two condensation. So when you have a two condensation, as long as these two fields do not point in the same direction, you break SU2 down to Z2. Yeah, that's basically the point. If you only have one condensation, you can only break SU2 down to U1. So actually, we have to design these ansatz, you know, quite carefully to make sure there's two condensation to get Z2. And the most actually, you know, we are talking about that. So this is this car design. So most likely, you have one condensation. You only break SU2 down to U1. So maybe the U1 gate theory is more relevant to high TC. The Z2 is harder to obtain. Yeah. Other questions? Yes. Yeah, I don't know. You know the. Yeah, there's Michael Hermely. Okay. Yeah, do you have studies? I think there's you studied something about how to calculate statistical vortex. I tried, but I am not successful. It's pretty elaborate calculation. Yeah. Yeah. Certainly, because this kind of vortex is kind of non-local. It's a, you know, in lattice gate theory, this vortex. It's not an easy object, and so it's not so easy to compute it. But maybe the best way to do that is using the string operator. But here the string operator are not exact, so they all have string tension. But probably still, So now I'm thinking about maybe even with using string operator with string tension, you can just ignore the string tension, pretend no string tension. That's probably still a better way. I never thought about this, but this is really the kind of open question. You know, for this kind of vortex like a defect, how to compute their statistic directly rather than using this indirect argument. Yeah, that's true. But here, but here is addressed with the fermion. I think the main concern that whether this M particle, whether there's some, for some reason, can trap some fermion Marana zero mode or something. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Yeah, 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 okay. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, that's a good point, yeah. So basically, it's whether one can, because the model described here is a little bit complicated. It's like you have a fermion, you have a lattice gate degree frame on the link. You know, it's like you have a gauge field on the link, fermion on the site. Then whether one can do some elaborate mapping, you know, in certain limit, you get rid of the fermion on the site, become purely a lattice gate theory on the link. The Z2 gate theory only have a degree of freedom on the link. There's nothing on the site. But one need to do some, if there's certain limits of mapping without closing the gap, then one probably can show this. Yeah, that's another way to do this. Okay. Okay, so this is a basically like a historical thing, you know. So now I'm switching to what we know after 2000. You know, before 2000, a lot of work is on this gate theory and a parton project construction, and so using this kind of a picture approach to study spin liquid. So more recently, we developed a different picture. But I thought this gate theory, this parton construction, is still very useful. So we're talking in the lunch. You say it should not be a lost art. So. It's still very useful, so that's why I can spend time to introduce it. So the more modern picture of this spin liquid can be viewed from this picture. That's suppose let's consider spin system. How to consider spin liquid? If you have a superposition of all kind of up and down spin, you get a kind of entangled states. But however, if you really make a superposition of all up and down spin, you actually get the product states. You do too much, you get the product states. So the every spin point in x direction, you know. So but how to make entangled state? If you don't do superposition, certainly that's a product state. If you do superposition of all possible configuration, you also get the product state. So something, if you do something in the middle, you may get a highly entangled state. So this is what we do. That's one motivation for the string. So we consider a string of a downspin. We say the downspin will form a string, form a loop. Okay, then we make a superposition of all those loop of downspins. So this is the one way to say we do not do superposition of every spin configuration, only do some superposition of some spin configuration, and only those for the loops. Okay. Or you can do this. Loop downspin with an amplitude which is -1 to the number of loop. You know, Michael talked about this. Or even more general, you can have some e to the I theta with the number of loop. Why not? You know. So maybe one wonder why Michael only talk about these two cases, don't talk about this case. You know. So then you can invent a lot of thing. Okay. And here I want to make a point is that whether this wave function can be specified by the local rule or not, actually is pretty important. Because here I write down the wave function directly. It's almost like you just write down an arbitrary many-body wave function, usually they are bad. You know, if you will write down an arbitrary many-body wave function, they are bad. The one which can be ground states are the one which can be select using local interaction. So here I'll translate that into the one that can be described by local rules. So this local rule and the selection via local interaction are related. Okay. So the first two actually can be obtained by local rule. The local rule is that the wave function does not depend on the shape of the string. And when string cross like this, switching the connection, they are the same. So this is a local rule. You just locally changing string. And then this like in Michael's talk, you know, the wave function specified by local rule can be selected by local Hamiltonian. And similarly, if you're changing sign of this local rule from plus to minus, you know, whenever reconnect, you add a minus sign, you can see that whenever things reconnect, the number of loop changes by one. Okay, so if you have a minus sign, then naturally that specifies the wave function of minus one to number of loops. So these two wave functions can be specified by local rules. But however, if you reconnect twice, you go back. So it seems that's only two possibilities. There's no third possibility. So that suggests that this wave function cannot be realized by local Hamiltonian. That's a pretty interesting statement. And I don't know whether one can prove that. So maybe via some entangled entropy. I wonder whether the entangled entropy have a volume law here instead of error law. Things like that, you know, something might happen, you know. Yes? That's right. So actually, you know, as Michael explained, this wave function is a double Samian, you know, have a Samian statistics. Then we know that the Samian cannot exist in three dimension. So therefore, actually, this wave function will become illegal or not locally specified in 3D, only 2D. And this one actually works in any dimension. This one works in any dimension, but this one only works in two dimension. And we can also see that. So in 3D, we may have a string crossing. You know, we just do projection. Now for this particular configuration, by string reconnection do not change the number of loop. Therefore, sometimes in three dimension, sometimes string reconnection can change the number of loop, sometimes they don't. So therefore, this local rule became inconsistent in three dimension. But this local rule consistent in any dimension. And so it gives you some idea, you know, how you play the game. Okay. And then now in two dimension, we have two wave function. You know, one is a equal with a superposition. Another is with a well amplitude dependent number of loops. And these two actually have a different statistics. And here I try to explain why they have a different statistics, you know. And I don't know, Michael can talk about this, but here's a very cartoon way to explain this. And you know, this with the ground state wave function have only loops. The end of a string will become topological excitation. It's something non-trivial. The reason for that is that the middle part of a string merge with a background string liquid, so it costs no energy. Only the end is observable, looks like a point particle. So therefore, a second open string do not like an extended object. It's like a two-point particle, one on each end. Okay. Then we want to ask, what is the statistics of this particle, which is correspond to string end? I don't know, but let's compute, what is the spin? What is spin? So to get the spin, we want to do the 360-degree rotation. So we have a string end. We do the 360 rotation to get its hooked states. But then something interesting happened. This hooked state and this straight state cannot fluctuate into each other because the string fluctuation like this reconnection. If you reconnect here, you get another hooked state. You never get a straight state. So actually, the string end have two sectors. the straight sector and the hooked sector. And the 360 rotation changes the straight to the hooked and the hooked to straight. But certainly, for the hooked state, you have the right hooked or left hooked, but these two are equivalent because these two can fluctuate into each other. So with the fluctuation, so these two are equivalent. So therefore, the 360 degree rotation behaves like this 2x2 matrix acting on these two sectors, hooked and straight. It have two eigenvalue, plus one, minus one. So straight plus hooked have a spin zero, which we call E. Straight minus hooked have a spin 1/2 because eigenvalue is minus one. So under 360 degree rotation, you're changing sign, that's spin 1/2. So we have a fractional angular momentum immediately. So that's already interesting. We have a fractional angular momentum. So for the Z2 series, like E and M, which have a fractional angular momentum. Okay. And however, if you're changing this wave function, so with a minus one in this reconnection rule, you'll find the spin is changed. Because in this case, the right hook and the left hook differ by a minus sign. So therefore, under 360 rotation, the straight became hooked. But the hooked became minus straight. There's additional minus sign here. So therefore, the 2x2 matrix became 0, minus 1, and 1, 0. And this one have two eigenvalue. This is straight plus I hooked have an eigenvalue of I, which is a spin a quarter, a minus quarter. There's a straight minus I hooked have a string spin a quarter. So you have a quarter spin. And because of this under 360 rotation, you get eigenvalue I. Okay. So at least you get a different angular momentum fractionalization for these two cases. So that's I saw this described in this paper. I think that's maybe the quickest way. Quick is a dirty way to see what's going on. and actually, using the same argument, you can get a spin statistical theorem. Is that when you exchange, so you have to be very careful when you exchange two particles, you have to be careful this string always going down, make sure you don't lose track of a straight or hook. So that's how we do the exchange. Then we can do this spin string reconnection to here, another string reconnection to here. But this can be plus or minus one, but when you do two of them, it's always plus one. So from after exchange, we can always go to here without any sign. But then we can see that corresponds to do a 360 rotation for one of a particle. So therefore, exchanging two particles is like doing 360 for one particle. Okay, at least for this situation. And then when you do 360 rotation for one particle, for the first case, we get a plus minus one, so therefore exchange can be boson or fermion. For the second situation, you get the I. Then exchange can be I. This exchange can be I or minus I. That's a fermion. So therefore, that's how we argue that this wave function, the end string behave like a fermion. For this wave function, end string behave like a boson or fermion. That's what we call double fermion model, and this is the toroidal model. So that's a kind of very quick way to do that. And actually, there is a formal way to do that is using the string operator. So I won't talk about now. Maybe in the next lecture, we will do the same calculation using the using string operator. We can also show that there's the statistics. Okay, I'll stop here. Yeah?
So this approach here, do you think this is specific to this?
I think it's more general, yeah. But to really study more general case, one need to Even I think even for non-abelian, but indeed only for exothermal model. Actually, that's a good question. You know, I think the way to test it is for this chiral model, whether this picture still works. Actually, I'm not sure. Probably don't. The chiral model may not have a string picture. But that's a very good question, actually. Whether for the but the string picture only for this solid model. But I think that for the string net model, this picture may also work. This line of thinking may also work for the string net model. Yeah. Yeah.
So all string net wave functions liquid.
Yeah, that's liquid. Yeah, it's kind of it's along the same direction. It's kind of superposition of some kind of spin configuration, but another superposition of all spin configuration is some subset. So there's a way which subset you choose. Again, there's a lot of game you can play. You can choose a subset of string, a subset of membrane, a subset of a bubble or sponge, you know, starfish, whatever. You know, that's a so certainly there's a question. So if you're choosing a proper subset, you may get a quantum gravity. You know, but we don't know yet. This part we don't know. What I try to say that if you do the string subset of a string, you mostly get a gauge theory. If you do condensation, choosing subset by condensing the membrane, you get this anti-symmetric tensor gauge field. This rank 2 anti-symmetric tensor. In higher dimension, you can condensing some 3 brain, you get a rank 3 anti-symmetric tensor. But the gravity is a symmetric tensor. So we have big trouble to see condensing what kind of geometry can give rise to gravity. Seems we can get anti-symmetric tensor very naturally. But we don't know how to do a symmetric tensor. So by condensing, by choosing subset is a way to construct entanglement. By choosing different subset, you're actually constructing different entanglement. So I wonder what is the general way, general design, so that you can construct all kind of entanglement via this. So actually, string net construction is a way that using that kind of procedure, you may construct almost all possible entanglement with a gap of a boundary. Yeah. So that's like a generic construction. Exactly. That's a very good one. Actually, that's different states. So there is a particular state where the amplitude do not depend on number of loop, but depend on the area this loop encloses. If you do that, the end of a string will see the flux, and then so that's good. End string have a fractionalized crystal momentum. You know, when end string see the flux, the end string will not have this Brillouin zone in the usual sense. It may have magnetic Brillouin zone, which is a smaller. So that is situation. So when the amplitude of the loop depend on area, the end string would have carry fractional crystal momentum. So that's belong to a symmetry in rich topological order. Means when you have translation symmetry, so that would belong to different phase. So indeed, this is a very good point. When you have a translation symmetry, you can insert this kind of error-dependent phase into it. And maybe there's many other things you can do. You know, with this kind of thinking, there's a lot of modification you can do. And they may also mean something. Yeah. What in by one loop? Okay. Yeah. I see. That's really interesting. But also, okay. Suppose that means that you have a. The weight is not a phase. Somehow, the weight is only one when you have one loop, and become zero for another number of loops. Okay. But the first thing, whether this is a, have a, can you specify this by local Hamiltonian? One may not be to do that with the local rules. And but this also suggests, actually that's something very suggestive. So if you don't require the local rule, that is a wave function. It's a, maybe the ground state of something. Or maybe you don't care it's ground state of anything, you just want to study that wave function. And so that this kind of illegal wave function, as you mentioned, in this case occurs from some non-unitary theory. I suspect that this one may also have a similar flavor, you know. And also, people ask, we'll talk about this question about, you know, we have some kind of construction like this. Symmetry is something. This one happened to be okay, it's unitary. But when you do other things, you may easily get something really weird non-unitary. And, but they may share something, that is, those wave function may be legal wave function, but for the quantum power state, we know that those wave function legal wave function, but they are not a gapped ground state. They are ground state of some gapless system. So those wave function cannot be a ground state of a gapped system. So so this is really very suggestive that by studying this non-unitary theory, you actually study gapless system, which is more exciting than gapped one. And so again, similar suggestions that whether this wave function with an arbitrary theta, or as you said, with only one loop, whether this is can be a starting point to attack gapless system via this non-unitary theory. This is a yeah, quite suggestive, actually. I don't know, yeah, but yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So then, it's a typical piece of freedom that a block is.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, yes.
But if I think of it as derived from a text representation, all those groups are
I think when you have only loops, it's more close. That's maybe exactly the Z2 gate theory. Yeah, but however, here we allow loop to break. So that's mean like a Z2 gate theory with a matter field. And so in condensed matter, we don't have pure Z2 gate theory because the Hilbert space of all the loops do not have this Dirac product decomposition on each side. So one could study just loops, you know, a system of loops, and everything's fine. But however, because the Hilbert space have no tensor product decomposition, the definition of locality in tangent entropy all became tricky because there you require the partition of a system using this Dirac product tensor product structure. And so here I limit myself to only study system whose total Hilbert space have a tensor product decomposition. So that means those loops are breakable. And
I guess what I mean is, in the Z2-gauge theory, if I draw a loop,
yeah.
The configuration is that sigma z is minus 1.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, that's right.
It seems like the only physical degree is
flux.
It doesn't matter if I'm wondering, some of those loops are, or maybe all of them, are gauge transforms to.
No, the one picture is that, you know, depending on what kind of superposition. Yeah. 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 So those loops are more like electric field line. Yeah, this loop is more like electric field line. Yeah.
In some representation, different loops are just getting transformed.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I don't want to count those. It doesn't exist.
Okay, yeah.
But when I put in the electric field representation,
yeah, that's right. Okay. Yeah.
So for this string net, like what is the constraint that I should put on like those string net, or there is no constraint? For example, I'm thinking.
Okay, if you do not put this branching rule, then what you get is.